the participants of the discussion are Sri Ghosh and Avanti Deosthale. I may also invite Dr. Giridhar Rao onto the dais, please. Dr. Giridhar Rao teaches at Asim Premji University, and he's an expert in educational policy. He was earlier working with the IIIT Hyderabad, and then in, I think, 2013, moved to the Asim Premji University. Over to Dr. Giridhar Rao.
And into Indian languages, including English, an Indian language, as we will see. Our first guest speaker here is Avanti Deosthale, who has translated the children's classic Heidi into Hindi last year. So I'll ask her to start first by asking an obvious question: why Heidi? It's a 19th century German Swiss classic. How is it that you happen to think of this as a text to translate, and how did you go about it? What was your source text? Was it the German original? Was it? So please go ahead.
So first of all, answering your question, Dr. Rao, why we chose Heidi, and you know, this is partly also justifying the topic of domesticating the alien. Heidi, for all the ones who have read it, you will know that Heidi is not an alien to us. I mean, she is very universal, she is very global, and she is a child who you will find everywhere. She probably has been a child in us as well, you know, while we were growing up. So why we chose Heidi, there are a couple of reasons. One of them being very personal, that me and my mother, we have had Heidi in our family for decades. So she loved Heidi as a child, and I loved her and the alm uncle and Peter and all of them even more. So, you know, I and her, we both felt that she had to be brought to the Indian literature realm as well, because Heidi has already been translated into more than 100 languages across the world. So doesn't India want to be a part of that population as well? And you know, why in Hindi? Because first of all, Hindi being our national language. Second thing is that many of the states in India have Hindi as their primary language, especially the states in the north, or you know, like the central parts of India. So these children, they must know, you know, what are these kinds of, the kind of books that are being published for children outside of India, otherwise they may not have an access to them at all. So this was the reason that Heidi had to come. She wanted to come for a long time, and we finally brought her here, and now she speaks in Hindi with all of you.
How did you go about the translation? Did you translate directly from the German, or did you?
No. Okay, so the translation of Heidi, actually, if you look at it that way, a simple task that it was, but my mother did the, you know, the harder part of the work. So since she has learned German, she was actually, for 2 years, she has been dedicatedly doing a lot of research. You know, she has read the German book. She has gone through a couple of films. Today, if you look at it, there are more than 20 films all across the world that have been made on Heidi. Just a day before, when we had the session at Nanha Nukkad, there was a little boy who came and told me that there is even a series in Telugu being aired on the televisions these days, which is, you know, on Heidi, and it's the Heidi is actually speaking in Telugu on the television. So well, my mother, she did the part of, you know, going to the institute in Switzerland, and, you know, studying more about her life, and, you know, trying to see, because Heidi has been translated into English already, but she just wanted to make sure that the version or the edition that we are using is doing full justice and is in complete commensuration with what Johannes Spidey had originally written. So that part was done by her. I just did the English to Hindi part. So ideally, actually, she should have been here on this panel because she could explain this much better. But since I did make Heidi talk in Hindi, so that's the reason I'm here.
That's great. Just to add to what Avanti is saying, some more Wikipedia gyan. Apparently, Heidi has been translated in, there are more than 125 editions of Heidi in Japanese alone. Do you have any sense of why it is such a popular text?
I think, Dr. Rao, the main reason lies in the fact that you can find Heidi's life being reflected in many parts of the world. So, you know, for example, I mean, since I have not been abroad or I don't really know about the children outside of India, what I have seen is where my mother works. You know, she's working for A&A Book Trust, which is, you know, they are having a library for children in a very small hamlet called Chatola. If I don't know if you all are familiar with this place called Mukteshwar in the Himalayan region. So those children have never had, you know, they don't even know the concept of a library. Rather, they didn't know. Now, Chatala has a library and they have brought all these books to them. So if you find, you know, you will find a very remarkable resemblance between Heidi's life and the life that these children are having there. You know, there are those snow-capped mountains. Life is very simple. Everyone knows everyone. And there are children who take the goats for, you know, for grazing or up on the hills and on the upper side of the mountains. And of course, there is an Indian version of the goat cheese that is made very, you know, regularly in many of the households there. So Heidi as such is not someone whom, you know, who actually feels like an alien or, you know, who feels like, okay, what is this girl all about? She's very much a part of our country. She's very much a part of every country, every place that you go to.
It's of course interesting that Heidi is a late 19th century text, no? Yeah. 1881 yeah. or something.
1881, yeah.
Yeah, that. So you're saying that in spite of being a late 19th century text, children in Mukteshwar, you said?
Yes,
And in that region, yeah, relate yeah. to it quite easily, nevertheless.
Oh yes. And in fact, you know, like when they were reading out a few chapters over there, so, you know, there was a story of, there is a character who's the grandmother, the blind grandmother in Peter's house. So while they were just reading out about the grandmother, one of the boys actually lifted his hand and he said, I also have a grandmother who's, you know, who's staying in the house and she's also she's a part of a corner. And, you know, we don't really talk much to her, but she also likes reading those religious texts. And, you know, she requests my mother to sing some hymns for her and all of that. So so we were all like, where was Heidi all this time? I mean, you know, she has been very much with us and, you know, for all these centuries, yes, she was not a part of the Indian languages, but she has been a part of our practical lives, and she still is.
One more question before I move to...
Definitely, yeah.
I was wondering, in the translation from your English, your source text was English, from English to Hindi, were there moments where you found the translation difficult because... there was some cultural information, or you said there is a kind of goat cheese made here also. That fine, but were there moments of difficulty as well? What did you find as a difficult part of the translation, or did it just flow?
To tell you the truth, Dr. Rao, there was nothing that was difficult, because the characters are very relatable. You will find, you know, reflections of what the Swiss Alps were at that time. As I said, in you know, the present day remote Himalayan villages, you'll also find those, the similar, you know, the pain or the difficulty or the suffocation that Heidi felt when she went to Frankfurt. You find that similar kind of a setup in the Indian cities today for the people who are leaving their villages and coming and migrating to the cities. So that way it wasn't difficult at all. I mean, it was, in fact, all that I had was, you know, this eagerness to do this as soon as I can and, you know, just bring it out to the children, because the children were waiting for it quite eagerly.
Yeah.
However, I would, I mean, since we are talking of difficult, I wouldn't call it as a difficulty, but what I and mother, my mother were, you know, deliberating on for a while was, you know, very, very minor things, but since we just wanted to make it perfect. So the original text has a part where, you know, Clara, that is the girl who is handicapped and Heidi's friend, she sends a packet of tobacco for the alm uncle. So while we were, you know, just discussing it with a couple of other editors and all, so one of them pointed out, you know, a child sending tobacco to a senior person would not be very welcome in the Indian context. So what my mother and I felt and what we reasoned with them, you know, the points with which we tried to reason was that, see, tobacco is very much again a part of every, almost every Indian household. I mean, we see a lot of seniors. You won't really find that ideal home everywhere, you know, and children are aware, you know, children have seen all of this happening in their homes. So, you know, while we were reading this out to the children in the Chatala library, we were looking at their expressions and trying to see, you know, what kind of response, but they didn't find anything different, you know, they were still, yeah, I know it happens in our home also. So it was nothing, so as such, there was no challenge at all.
So it was tambaku in Hindi, is it?
Tambaku, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Fascinating. Yeah. And you, it's particularly interesting that you piloted the translation, so to speak. No? You read it out to those children in Chatala.
Yeah.
So that
I personally didn't, but my mother and Mr. Arvind Kumar did. Yeah.
And did you make changes in the text thanks to those sessions?
No, not at all.
Oh, I see. Okay.
No. So they have been brought out just the way they were.
Fascinating.
Absolutely.
Fascinating. Thanks so much. Shall we move on to us three now?
Yes, please. Yeah? Please.
You two have, you've translated in many genres for many ages, but since we are talking about Heidi, let's begin with your translation of children's works, specifically your translation of Tagore into English for the 21st century. Once again, here is a text that has been available in multiple translations, I assume, in English. Why did you think of a new translation of Tagore's stories into English? It's called A Rat's Feast, is it not?
Yes.
And other stories?
Yeah,
please.
Tagore has been, Tagore translated himself, uh-huh. And he was translated by very many translators. So for me, when the publishers asked if I would be interested in translating Tagore, I was a bit nervous, because there were so many people who had translated Tagore. And but when I look at some of the translations, I felt, no, I wanted it in the language that we speak today, in Indian English of the 21st century. And because the problem with Tagore is that people hold him in such respect that when they translate him, the language is quite stilted, I found. Anyway, that's my opinion, you know. So I thought, no, it has to be a language. For example, when you're translating a play for children, it has to be a language which children could say on stage. You can't, when I translate plays, I've done a lot of plays, you know, I have to think about, I try to be as close to the original in the intention and in the length of the sentence. Many things that we think of, because if it's a sentence is a 5-word sentence, you don't want to translate that into a 15-word sentence, you know. And yet you've got to. There are many considerations. But my point is that the words have to be breathable. If someone says a sentence, it has to be breathable, it has to be speakable, there has to be all these things that you think of. And so the first thing that comes to your mind might not be the right thing that you translate. And Rabindranath Tagore was interested in modernizing Bengali. And his, you know, he spoke of the Sadhu Bhasha and the Chalit Bhasha. And so my point is that the English that we use should also be Chalit Bhasha. It should not be Sadhu Bhasha. And so that was my basic philosophy.
Interesting that you mentioned plays. Have you actually had the experience of children performing those or reading them out aloud, the English versions? That your
with
English
Tagore's version? I haven't seen that. No, I haven't, actually, unfortunately.
It might be a project to think about.
Get
children to. But you've also translated, but this Rat's Feast and other stories, these are stories, aren't they? They're not plays. They're short stories.
There's plays. There's two plays. Hmm. There's The House of Cards. Uh-huh. And then there's the Post Office.
Ah, yes.
And then there is some poems and some stories. And again, with the poems, I've taken poems that everybody learns at school, like Where the Mind is Without Fear, uh-huh. and I've made new versions of them. So some people might not like it. I mean, I've read reviews and someone's going, what's she gone and done, you know? But some people like them.
Tagore is, of course, a much celebrated and translated writer. The other translations you have done, and you've done so many in so many directions, will you tell us a little bit more about those, the Adi Granth translation and the Ibsen translations into Hindi?
The Adi Granth, in 1984, mm-hmm. I was a journalist. Mm-hmm. I had done programs for children, and I had done programs on music, the radio, and then Indira Gandhi was killed, and I was in Delhi, and Norwegian Radio asked me to cover the riots, and for me that was the first time I was doing political journalism, but I was standing in my own city and seeing it burning, and it was for me in my life it was a moment that. There was a before and an after. And after the riots, I went and did relief work in refugee camps, or whatever you call them, camps for people affected by the riots, for 3 months. And I realized that I didn't know very much about Sikhism, and it gave me an interest in Sikhism. So when someone asked me later to translate songs from the Adi Granth to Norwegian, I spent a year translating, and it was I realized the beauty of the poetry. It gives you great peace, and so it was a wonderful experience. Later on, a couple of years ago, I translated not to Norwegian but to English, to Indian English. I translated for Hachette a book with stories about Guru Nanak, and then from his poems. So they're my reactions to 1984 that I later transformed into work. Yeah. Ibsen is a different thing. I've been working for the last 9 years on translating Henrik Ibsen to Hindi, and four of my plays have been translated and performed. And
performed too?
Yeah, performed as well. Here in Hyderabad a year ago, there was a performance of Ghosts at the University of Hyderabad, which was an amazing performance. And they've been performed at the Sri Ram Center and India International Center, NCPA. So I had the occasion to read from Ghosts with Tom Alter a couple of years ago at NCPA, and he was an amazing actor, and he hearing how he brought life to the translation was quite an experience.
And this is mid 19th century Norwegian, right? That you're translating into 21st century Hindi.
Yes.
The style is, of course, one of realism.
Yes.
So did that make your job easier, you think?
I think that you have to, all the time when you translate a play, you have to remember that this is something people are saying. So in An Enemy of the People, there's a scene where the Dr. Stockman, who's a doctor who's protesting because there's a polluted water in this bath in the city. So Dr. Stockman comes with a speech, and then there's a whole crowd of people shouting at him. And I just think, okay, so if they're shouting, you've got to remember that they're not saying aap, they're saying tu. If people scream at you, workers at a thing, they're not going to be being saying aapne bahut bura kiya yahan pe. They're going to
use
all kinds of language. So I keep that in mind, who's speaking, where, when, how polite do you have to be. And also, you know, some of Ibsen's characters are people who are not very educated but are trying to sound very posh. And they sometimes make mistakes, like in The Wild Duck, uh-huh. Gina is like that. So then you've got to think about it. She makes mistakes and she says, for example, instead of saying pistol, she says pistol in Norwegian is pistol. So she doesn't say pistol, she says pigstool.
Mm-hmm.
And so then what do I say in Hindi? So for bandook, some people say dambook.
Mm-hmm.
And so I just, you know, I think of these kind of things when I'm choosing words.
Yeah. Fascinating.
And swearing. In, this is a problem in terms of domesticating it, that Ibsen is writing in a Christian context. And so in Norway, blasphemy is very important in swearing. In India, sex is more, you know. So I can't translate a religious swearing to sala or this or that, you know, remembering your mother or your sister fondly. I think of, I just think, okay, so I will try and translate when he says Satan, or when they use the name of God in vain, which happens often. So I just use biblical language in Urdu or Hindi. And my point is that when you're translating a play, you're translating it and trying to do it as faithfully as possible. You're giving a director a manuscript, and then the director has to make what he wants out of it. And the director can choose to put in whatever swear words he will put into the text. That is up to the director. But I will try and translate what Ibsen said as faithfully as I can. And then any director will make a production and choose to keep something and take out something. Yeah. But this project that I'm working on is very interesting because we're translating at the same time Ibsen to classical Arabic, Egyptian, Spanish, Russian, Chinese, Japanese, and Hindi. And we're a group of translators and we meet twice a year and we go through a play line by line and discuss, you know, because we all understand Norwegian and we all have problems with some things and all of us stop at the same. We send in our problems before we're going to come to a meeting to each other, and we've all stopped to the same places because we're stuck with this. How do you explain this? How do you explain that? When you translate a play, there's no point in thinking about footnotes because when the actor's standing on the stage, you cannot have some balloon coming out from under his feet, you know. So you have to try and translate it as, you know, in a way that you don't need footnotes. And so all of us, but the fact is that we're this team that translates across the world. We're in touch with each other on WhatsApp and Facebook and everything. And so we have resource persons for, you know, I mean, I don't know what to do about this. What would you do in Arabic, I would say. And then very often the Persian word or the Arabic word might be something I could use. Or now they've started asking me, what did you say in Hindi? Mm. And you know, it might be something that might inspire them. And for the Japanese and the Chinese also, they consult with each other. So it's a wonderful way of working together, and we're so privileged to be able to do it.
Fascinating. Thank you for sharing the current project. I wanted to ask Avanti, what is your current project? Is there a Heidi Part 2, or is there something else, some other text that has caught your eye?
Oh, well, by asking that, I'm letting the cat out of the bag for a while. I'm just letting her peep a little. Well, ever since I read Heidi, the inkling or the itch to have a sequel that has been playing on my mind, and I do have a sort of a structure ready, but because I would like to know what happened to Clara, what happened to Peter, what happened to Heidi, what kind of people do they become when they grow up. So I believe there are a couple of sequels that have already come about. But most of them are going towards, there is a First World War that happens, and then Peter becomes a part of, he's going in the war. And in most of them, I think even Heidi ends up marrying Peter. So I somehow feel that, Heidi's story is not something that needs all this, regular amalgamation of all these very mundane things happening. So what I plan to do with them is something that I hope I would be able to bring out soon, and you all would feel that it is at least a bit of a justice to what Johanna Spidey would have actually envisioned all of them to be when they were all grown-ups. And at present, I'm also working on a translation of a Norwegian book. It is again for children, and the title itself is the protagonist, Astrid Glimmerdal.
Mm-hmm.
Astrid Glimmerdal, as you would have corrected me. Okay, so, and Astrid is a girl I'm already in love with. I'm sure you'll love her as well. She is a person, she's just 9 years old, but she can literally, turn the world upside down. If in case anybody has read Pippi Longstocking or Pippi Longstrump, you'll see a lot of, similarities between Pippi and Astrid. Although they come from different countries, Pippi is from Sweden and Astrid is from Norway, and the authors are naturally different. But I love them, and I'm sure you all will as well. So now Astrid is going to speak in Hindi very soon.
Excellent.
So that would be out in the market very soon.
Excellent. I see in the audience a large number of translators, or many people interested in translation. Perhaps we can open it up now for a couple of comments
definitely.
Or questions.
Sure.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Hello, good morning. I have a question for Astrid. I was just wondering when you were talking that a couple of things. One is, first of all, I'm just curious, how many languages do you know? And I was wondering, how is it that you developed this, and even you, actually, how is it that you develop this interest in learning so many languages? And I mean, do you set out trying to, or is it just a love of, or what is it that you want to do different languages and master in, especially in today's context where we are all increasingly English, and how do you master this to be able to do justice to an original piece of work in an Indian language? And the other thing is, you in your conversation, you said a lot of things that you have been asked to do. And my question to you is there something, what makes you take a decision that you want to do this?
Right.
And what is it that, and do you have something that you want to do independently of anybody commissioning it for you? Is there a work that is really that you want to do it?
The question is to both of you, so maybe instead of taking another question, maybe perhaps if I can ask you to both respond to it.
Well, ma'am, if I am to answer that question, I don't know many languages. I know English, Hindi, because Hindi I know very well because I was brought up in Delhi, so there was anyway no choice. Yes, I do know Marathi because I am a native Marathi. My written Marathi is laughable. So I hope you all don't have to suffer my Marathi translations. Yes, and I know a bit of Assamese and Bengali as well. But I think as far as this wanting to learn a language is concerned, for me it is, more, for me language is an expression. So, what I have, especially when you see in these Indian languages, since the base is Sanskrit, so you'll see a lot of similarity, which is why I think Indian languages as such, if you know a couple of them, it's not really a challenge to learn the others. So Assamese and Bengali, for that matter, they are extremely similar. If you know one, you can learn the other very easily. While translating them, these original masterpieces that have not been originally in Hindi, bringing them to the Indian context, the primary concern that plays on my mind, very similar to what Astri goes through, is, I imagine the character speaking to me.
Mm-hmm.
So, if, for example, if it's Astri Glimmerdal that I'm dealing with now, or if it's P.P. Longstocking, or whether it's, Mama Moo and the Crow, I always imagine that had they been here, and if there is a child who's sitting next to me, I have to make sure that whatever they have spoken in English over there is the same that the child understands here, just in Hindi. So yes, that concern for certain words which have to be as close to the original language as possible is always there. But again, I again agree with Asri that, you try to make the written language as close to the colloquial instead of, the literature part. Mm. So that is something, especially when you're doing it for children, you have to be very careful because you can't put in those heavy words and, leave those little ones just grappling for, what is being meant by this. It's a simple, simple story, and the language has to be as simple and as relatable to the child as possible.
Astri, the languages you speak and wanting to do translations rather than being asked to.
The languages, I come from a multilingual home. My parents spoke Bengali and Norwegian, but we spoke English at home, and I went to a Hindi medium school. That just started, that was my start in life. And for me, in the school I went to, I had Tamil as my third language, Hindi as my first language, English was my second language. My Tamil is I cannot, I boast of it. I'm just mentioning it as one of the languages that I learned, but my Tamil is non-existent. And then I went to Norway when I finished school, and I had German as a language and Norwegian as the main language. And I studied a bit of Tibetan, a bit of Sinhalese, a bit of on the way. For me, it's like cracking a code. You learn a language and it's cracking a code. You suddenly see patterns and you understand things. And Dravidian languages and North Indian languages, there are big differences. I'm right now, 1.5 years ago, I had a head injury and I couldn't use my computer for 3 months. And I started thinking about other things to do. I started painting, I started doing enamel, making jewelry. I started learning Portuguese. I had to do something else. And now I've translated 3 children's books from Portuguese. So my point is that I have to translate them to a language which I know properly. My Bengali is rather poor, but as in spoken. But I read Bengali, I understand Bengali, so I wouldn't translate to Bengali ever. But for me, the languages that I function well in to translate into are Hindi, English, and Norwegian. And those 3 languages I translate into. The first book I translated was from Urdu. It was Kurutala and Heather's short stories that I translated to Norwegian.
Hmm. One last question I believe we have time for. Yes, sir. Here. Briefly, please.
Yeah. Hi, ma'am. As far as the translations in the actual literature is concerned, it's absolutely fine. But when we see day-to-day magazines like India Today, if they have something called as zenith of power, they'll say Rajakiya Shikhara Ghrana. They'll use very high sounding words. So is there any way to bring colloquialism even in the day-to-day magazines also? Point number one. Second point is that I'm into IT industry where there is no scope to learn anything other than the software. So, but I'm very much interested in learning the languages. So is there any easy way, rather, I would not call it easy way, an interesting way to learn new languages? It's something like watching movies or reading books. What would you suggest if I want to learn a new language as the first step? I'm done with my question. Thank you.
Thank you. Who would like to take that?
Could I answer? When I want to learn a new language, I will, for example, watch, right now when I'm trying to learn Portuguese, I will watch English television with Portuguese subtitles. And then you're getting it in automatically. I mean, that's one way of doing it. There are lots of online courses. There's lots of interactive stuff that should make it easier for you. And in terms of this very stilted language that we have in the magazines and the news magazines and stuff, that's a battle. I think it's very important to write as simply as possible. But I don't believe in domesticating the alien 100%. I think that there's been a lot of debate about what they call foreignization and domestication. And the talk about, there's this professor called Lawrence Venuti who speaks about retaining the foreignness, as many have spoken before him, about retaining the foreignness in a text so that people can see that the text is foreign. It's not, and that the translator is not invisible. You've got to see that this is a translation. So I do believe myself as well on that one shouldn't totally transform a text so that it reads very fluently and nobody can see that this is a translation. That's not the aim of the translation. You have to see. For me, it's important that Ibsen was a Norwegian. He wasn't from, Uttar Pradesh. Hmm. And so keeping some of that is important. But I've been working with some children in Goa who's struggling with Hindi. And when I was a kid, when I went to school in Delhi, we used to use NCERT textbooks, and we used to say, Raja, Rani Madan Amar, and they would come and they would go and swing on the swings and play. Now what they're doing is that the sentences in the first class, the children are not saying Raja, but they're saying Nripa. They're not saying, to say that the bull went into the garden, they're saying Vrishab. Udyan mein gaya. You ask a first class child to read Vrishab Udyan mein gaya, and that child is going to hate Hindi. And then when he, honestly, Raja Rani, you can talk about Raja Rani. No, you talk about Nripa.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking our speakers, Avanti and Astri.
Thank you.